أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين محمد بن عبد الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي اللهم اجعل تجمعنا هذا تجمعا مرحوما وتفرقنا من بعده تفرقا معصوما ولا تجعل فينا ولا بيننا شقيا ولا محروما إنك ولي ذلك والقادر عليه أما بعد. This evening, inshallah, we talk about hadith number 15 in al-Ahadeeth al-Nawawiyyah, which is narrated by Abi Hurairah radiyallahu anhu wa ardaah. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من كان يؤمن بالله واليوم الآخر فليقل خيرا أو ليصمت ومن كان يؤمن بالله واليوم الآخر فليكرم جاره ومن كان يؤمن بالله واليوم الآخر فليكرم ضيفه. Narrated by Al-Bukhari and Muslim. This hadith talks about the perfection of the moral characters, and it divides the rights into two different categories, one of which is the rights that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has upon us, and second, the rights of the slaves among each other. So in the first statement in this hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, مَنْ كَانَ يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. Whoever truly believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, meaning that they have such keen belief that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants the best for them, and He's sending them a message at the tongue of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that whoever wishes to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on Judgment Day on favorable terms, because the hadith the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Man kana yu'minu billahi wal yawmil akhir," and it's a prerequisite to believing in the Day of Judgment, is that we believe that we shall stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we shall answer for everything that we have done, we shall be held accountable for everything that we said or did or believed in. So here, this is a tremendous reminder for us that we are held accountable for everything that we say. And in the first statement, the Prophet ﷺ says, مَنْ كَانَ يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. Whoever truly believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Judgment Day, فَلْيَقُلْ خَيْرًا, let them say that which is khayr. And khayr here is whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded us to do in terms of the obligatory acts of worship. So that includes the pillars of Islam. That includes the dhikr, remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, istighfar, invoking peace and blessings upon His Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and all sorts of statements that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala likes, accepts and rewards us for. So this is the definition of khayr, the obligatory acts of worship, and then following the mandub, that which is preferred and liked by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where He rewards for, and of course forbidding that which is munkar, that falls under the category of khayr, to forbid that which is munkar, which what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made prohibited. We mentioned this ayah and other hadith before. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala defines for us statements that have khayr in it. And khayr means good and goodness, and that which the Sharia approves and accepts. That which the Sharia approves of and accepts. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَا خَيْرَ فِي كَثِيرٍ مِّن نَجْوَاهُمْ إِلَّا مَنْ أَمَرَ بِصَدَقَةٍ أَوْ مَعْرُوفٍ أَوْ إِصْلَاحٍ بَيْنَ النَّاسِ. That there is not much good in the talk that people involved in, and there is so much talk that goes around. Subhanallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us the ni'mah, this bounty of the tongue and ability to speak. And with it, one can enter the fold of Islam, and with it, one can exit the fold of Islam. With this tongue, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, as reported in the authentic hadith narrated by Al-Bukhari and Muslim, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, إِنَّ الْعَبْدَ لَيَتَكَلَّمُ بِالْكَلِمَةِ مِنْ رِضْوَانِ اللَّهِ. That the slave will speak a word or a short statement where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala likes and approves of. يَرْفَعُهُ بِهَا فِي الْجَنَّةِ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will elevate the ranks of this slave in paradise beyond the expectations of this slave. وَإِنَّ الْعَبْدَ لَيَتَكَلَّمُ بِالْكَلِمَةِ مِنْ سَخَطِ اللَّهِ. And the abd will speak words that in it there is the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لَا يُلْقِي لَهَا بَالَ. In the first statement, لَا يُلْقِي لَهَا بَالَ means they're not paying much attention to what they're saying. But in the first statement, or the first part of the hadith, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala likes what this abd has said. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raises this abd with the good words that he or she have said. And in the second part of the hadith, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, min sakhatillah, from that which angers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Again, la yulqi laha bala. Could be a joke, could be a vain statement, could be just something that people use to establish rapport between each other. And as a result, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, will cause him to enter the hellfire deep in its layers, wal'iyadu billah, with just one word. I recall one statement that a brother was engaged in a dialogue with a Christian that he has said. And that gives us an idea as to what some of these words mean that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala likes, accepts, and rewards for. So they were talking about, Isa alayhi salam. And the Muslim brother said, if Isa alayhi salam were to come back in my lifetime, I'd be honored to carry his shoes around. Why? Because we honor all the prophets and the messengers. Similar words like that, the brother may not have given it much attention, but these are the taboo words, yani wallahu ta'ala a'la wa a'lam, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala elevates, the ranks of Muslims with. Because these are the taboo words that when they're measured to the truth, they measure very well. Because indicate the belief of the Muslim that we believe in all the prophets and the messengers, that we do not practice fanaticism and take one side over the other, or prefer one over the other, or raise one by putting the other one down. We honor all of them, they all are the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they all spoke the truth and they all did deliver the message according to the creed of the Muslim. So here we see how dangerous this tongue is and how bountiful this tongue can be, because again, in the hadith, it's mentioned that كلمتان خفيفتان على اللسان ثقيلتان في الميزان حبيبتان للرحمن سبحان الله وبحمده سبحان الله العظيم. In this hadith, the Prophet ﷺ tells us that two words, خفيفتان على اللسان, this bounty, this ni'mah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us, the tongue, they are very, very light for the tongue, and it doesn't matter if one spoke the Arabic language or not, they can actually grasp onto these words and they can learn them and they can practice them. خفيفتان على اللسان ثقيلتان في الميزان, that in the scales of the hasanat of the believer on judgment day, it will weigh very heavily. حبيبتان للرحمن, they are most loved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. سبحان الله وبحمده سبحان الله العظيم سبحان الله وبحمده سبحان الله العظيم. Without the ability to speak, without this bounty of the tongue, we can never utter these words. We can never proclaim the shahada, لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله, where every act of goodness and every statement of goodness and every act of dhikr that is acceptable to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala must be met first and foremost by the prerequisite of لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله فهي منبع كل خير. It is the spring of every goodness that one can engage in. So we can see how bountiful, this ni'mah is, this bounty from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and how much good we can do with it. However, we must recall the ayat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Qaf, when he says, مَا يَلْفِظُ مِنْ قَوْلٍ إِلَّا لَدَيْهِ رَقِيبٌ عَتِيدٌ. Every statement that we utter, every word that we say, it is written in our books. And many of the scholars said, do not speak in matters that you don't wish to see it in your book, on Judgment Day. So therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with this tongue, and alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put this tongue between, two prisons, if you will. The jaws and the lips. And in spite of that, we seem to overcome these two, prisons, and we seem to allow this tongue, to exit and speak freely without paying much attention to what this tongue is saying, which oftentimes, unfortunately, gets us in trouble. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala defines for us that which He loves. لا خير في كثير من نجواهم. There is not much good in the words that they speak. إلا من أمر بصدقة. Except one who enjoins an act of charity. أو معروف أو إصلاح بين الناس. معروف is whatever the sharia, the legislation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts as something good. For example, recitation of the Quran. Learning the ahadith. Passing on knowledge. Enjoining the good. Forbidding the evil. All these good things are considered ma'roof, that are liked and accepted by the sharia, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rewards us tremendously by engaging in that. أو إصلاح بين الناس, or reconciling the differences of two disputing parties or brothers, resolving a conflict that is taking place between them or between two sisters. So this is the first part of the hadith where the Prophet ﷺ, in telling us about these etiquettes, He wants us to perfect our moral character, and he wants us to be vigilant about that which we say. And as we recall from the hadith of Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiallahu ardah, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commanded Mu'adh to watch his tongue and be careful about what he says. So Mu'adh radiallahu ardah responds by saying, O Prophet of Allah, are we going to be held accountable for everything that our tongues say? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam responded by saying, Thakilatka ummuka ya Mu'adh, means that, you know, it's a statement expressing, you know, deep concern about Mu'adh and what he had said. It said, وَهَلْ يَكُبُّ النَّاسَ عَلَىٰ مَنَاخِرِهِمْ in one narration, وَعَلَىٰ وَجُوهِهِمْ in another narration. إِلَّا حَصَائِدُ أَلْسِنَتِهِمْ Is it the case that the majority of people are flung into the hellfire upon their faces or upon their noses, except by way of that which their tongues have earned? And again, the hadith are endless, but I will mention this one last hadith where the Prophet ﷺ says, that whoever guarantees for me his tongue and that which is between, you know, that which is between his jaws and that which is between his thighs, meaning that the tongue and the private part from engaging in that which is unlawful, that which is forbidden, the Prophet ﷺ says, I guarantee for him or for her paradise. I guarantee for him or for her, you know, paradise. This is enough of an incentive for us to be extremely watchful of what we say. Then the Prophet ﷺ says, وَمَنْ كَانَ يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ فَلْيُكْرِمْ جَارَهُ And whoever truly believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Judgment Day, فَلْيُكْرِمْ جَارَهُ The word Kareem, it means that so many good qualities have gathered in a person that raises this person above others. So many good qualities that have gathered in this person that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala likes, and that the Prophet ﷺ is taught us, that raises this person above, you know, others who are competing with this person. So here the Prophet ﷺ commands us again to be honorable and to be kind and to be compassionate and to be kurama, kareem, towards our neighbors. So how do we, you know, apply this statement in today's life? Number one, neighbors are three different types, meaning that three different levels. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالْجَارِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى وَالصَّاحِبِ بِالْجَنْبِ الْجَارِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى has been interpreted by the scholars to mean, one interpretation to mean that your next door neighbor or your neighbor that is also a relative of yours, means that this person is a neighbor and is a Muslim and is a relative. And this is the neighbor that has the highest level of rights over us. Why? Because three qualities have gathered in this neighbor. Number one, the right of neighborhood. And then number two, the right of the fact that he or she are a Muslim. Number three, the right of the fact that he or she are a relative of ours, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded us, you know, in the Quran and in the hadith to be kind, compassionate, and observe the rights that he has made between us, you know, as relatives, as those who hold blood relations. So the second category, or the second level, which steps down, meaning that one who is a neighbor and a Muslim, but not a relative. So their rights are a bit lesser. And then the third is one who is a neighbor, right, but neither a Muslim nor a relative. So in the first category, we have, you know, the highest level of rights above us. The second has, you know, somewhere in the middle. And third still has rights upon us, in spite of the fact that they are not a relative and they're not a Muslim. The first right that a neighbor has over us is for us, for him to be safe and secure and protected from any evil, any harm that we may inflict upon this neighbor. In the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ mentions a woman. In fact, this woman was mentioned in front of the Prophet ﷺ when the Sahaba said, a woman, sawwama qawwama. Sawwama qawwama is that she fasts often. And here talks about the nafila, doesn't talk about the month of Ramadan. Qawwama means she stands up in the third part of the night, doing qiyam al-layl, frequently. وَلَكِنَّهَا تُؤْذِي جِيرَانَهَا However, she harms her neighbors. What did the Prophet ﷺ say? قَالَ هِيَ فِي النَّارِ He said, she is in the hellfire. And then they tell her about another one who is not really, doesn't have, you know, the qualities of the first one, meaning that she does not really fast much beyond that which is obligatory, and she does not do qiyam al-layl much, you know, beyond that which is, you know, obligatory, the five daily prayers. However, she does not harm her neighbors. She is good to her neighbors. He said, "Hiya fil Jannah." She is in paradise. So it's not really the quantity of the deeds that we do, but it's the quality and the character that these deeds produce in us. And in the hadith, Prophet ﷺ tells us that most people enter, or أكثر ما يدخل الجنة, the reason that mostly cause people to enter paradise, حسن الخلق. حسن الخلق means one who has the best of character. So if we see someone who is extremely knowledgeable and doing قيام الليل and doing صيام and spending في سبيل and all of that, however their character is no good, then he or she will be far distant from the Prophet ﷺ on Judgment Day, and they could end up in the hellfire وَالْعِيَادَ بِاللَّهِ. And if we see someone who is solely doing the obligatory acts of worship and staying from that which is prohibited, however their character is good, they're going to be the closest to the Prophet ﷺ on Judgment Day, and this will be a cause for them to enter paradise. So we can see that Islam is about producing that Muslim character in us, just like what the Prophet ﷺ said, إِنَّمَا بُعِثْتُ لِأُتَمِّمَ مَكَارِمَ الْأَخْلَاقِ. I was sent to perfect the moral character of those who follow me. And in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives his divine testimony to the Prophet ﷺ, where he gives him testimony to nothing else aside from this by saying, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. Indeed, you are a man of a great character. Imagine Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying this to the Prophet ﷺ, and in it there is a signal for us that we need to follow. لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. In this man, the best of men to walk the face of the earth, there is a fine example for us to, you know, to follow. So this is really the best that we could do for ourselves, and this is how we guarantee a very close place, you know, to the Prophet ﷺ on Judgment Day, and a very high place in paradise, you know, Allahumma ameen. And of course, the scholars have disagreed as to who is really considered to be a neighbor. Is it just the one who is next to me, and the one who is in front of me, and behind me, and on my left? Or is it the seventh, as some scholars have said, you know, up to the seventh neighbor in every direction? And some said it's actually up to 40 neighbors, you know, front, back, right, and left. Now, the scholars in an effort, other group of scholars in an effort to reconcile the differences, they said it's left to the urf. The urf means that the culture. And the culture differs, you know, in every country. So you see sometimes the culture in one part of the world is slightly different from another. You see also the way people live, you know, in one part of the world different from the way people live in other parts. Some live in a high-rise building, so they have, mashallah, they have 1,000 people living in that building. You know, they hardly know, you know, any of them, or, you know, some of their names. And then you see people who are just like in the village where everybody knows everyone, right? And then you see people who live maybe in the suburbs, where, you know, the suburbs where basically there's some level of ties that are well conceived. But people who live in the city, typically they are very distant from one another. So really the urf plays, you know, the culture plays a big factor in that. But again, we as Muslims, you know, we approach everyone with a smile and with kindness, with the ability to, you know, whatever we can offer to help, so on and so forth, because we offer them the best of the best, which is Islam. So by showing our generosity and our good character with them, and you know, protecting them from our harm, and helping them with their, you know, day-to-day lives, and facilitating the process for them, this is really the best da'wah we can give to them. And the last and the third and the last part of the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ also says, وَمَنْ كَانَ يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ فَلْيُكْرِمْ ضَيْفًا. And whoever truly believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Judgment Day, then let them be generous, and be kind and practice proper etiquettes towards their guest. So what is the proper etiquettes from an Islamic perspective towards our guest? Number one, if someone, of course, that also depends on where you live. So in the small towns and in the villages where there are no open markets and restaurants and hotels and motels and all of that, if a guest comes to the town, we are obligated at minimum, and when I say at minimum, that's a fard, obligatory, to host this person. To host this person. And that's why you see in the tribal system in the past, they would have a tent that's called the hospitality tent. So if somebody comes from out of town, a travel or whatever, that's where they stay. There's a hospitality tent, they provide them with food and water and clothing and everything they need. Why? Because there is no other place to secure that. There's no other place to secure that. So the first day and the first night is obligatory. The second and the third is considered a sadaqah. is considered a sadaqah. Beyond that also follows as an act of sadaqah. And that's why we read in Surah Al-Kahf, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about Musa alayhi salam and Al-Khidr when they were traveling, فَاسْتَطْعَمَا أَهْلَهَا فَأَبَوْا أَن يُضَيِّفُوهُمَا. They ask for food and water and, you know, what people need when they're traveling. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَأَبَوْا, they refuse to what? Give them their right to hospitality. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not say, and they refuse to give them charity. No. They refuse to give them their right. And of course, these people obviously from, you know, their characters, they don't have the best of character, because that's an obligation upon them. And this is something, in fact, in the past, even prior to the days of Islam, prior to the coming of the message, you know, the Arabs back then, they used to compete, you know, to give food and water and whatever basic life necessities, you know, to the pilgrims and to those who were traveling and all of that. So they used to, you know, consider that as something that they would pride themselves with, and rightfully so. So some of the etiquettes that we observe is that when one is invited as a guest to someone's home, is that number one, to lower their gaze and to sit where the host asked them to sit, because the host knows their house and they know what, where the awra is, you know, where things that they should not be looking at or whatever. So to host them in that, to observe the etiquette. Not to be a very heavy guest, meaning that do not demand beyond what the host is offering for you. And we as Muslims, there's no tukalluf. We don't have to go out of our way. You know, if I go to somebody's house or they come to my house, I don't have to go and buy, you know, a lamb or, you know, a cow and slaughter it and grill it and say, here it is, and I only have one guest. You know, what are you offering? You offer so much for just one person. So there's no takalluf, because, you know, we sort of like, we are brothers. We are brothers in the millah. So therefore, if I need something, I should freely ask. And if a guest comes to me and they need something, I should not even give him a chance to ask. I should offer them. So if somebody comes to my house, I would immediately offer, would you like something to eat? Or I would just, without even asking, put something on the table, say, you know, I haven't eaten yet, so let's have something to eat together. And in the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ says, you know, the food for three is enough for four, and the food for four is enough for five. So in other words, you don't have to go out of your way to add more to what you already prepared if a third and a fourth and a fifth guest comes, meaning that what you have on the table is sufficient. Unless, of course, you invite five and then 15 show up, then that's a different story. Yeah. And you may want to add a little bit more to that. So these are the rights of the guest upon the host. And of course, the guest should not really prolong their stay. And in other words, should not get too comfortable, you know, after the first day and the second day and the third day. Because the Prophet ﷺ says in the hadith, also it is roughly translated, means that you as a guest do not stay at the host's house to the extent that you make him commit sin. How do you make him commit sin? Is that you burden him beyond their capacity. Means that now they're, you know, alhamdulillah, we live in a place where hardly anybody's short on food, you know, and food is abundant, you know, in everybody's home and, you know, in the adjacent grocery stores or what have you. But that's really not the case everywhere. That's not the case everywhere. You know, many people around the world, they barely have the food to eat for the day. So if you go and you stay there for a day and two and three and ten, then you have burdened, you know, this host beyond their capacity, and you have really pushed them to commit sinful behavior. Perhaps they feel the pressure where they have to go borrow money or to go get something unlawfully or any of that. That should not be the case. That should not be the case, because in the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ says, مَا أُخِذَ بِسَيْفِ الْحَيَاءِ فَهُوَ حَرَامٌ. Whatever has been taken by the sword of what? Bashfulness. Means that you've embarrassed this person to give you something that they really did not want to give it to you. You've embarrassed this person to give up something that they really would not give it up unless, you know, you put them in that awkward position and make them feel awkward to the extent that they say, here, take it. You know, I don't want it, or it's yours if you like it. So these are some of the etiquettes which also go hand in hand, you know, in many of the ahadith that we talked about that teaches us the proper etiquettes as Muslims. So in the first part of the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ says, مَنْ كَانَ يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ فَلْيَقُلْ خَيْرًا أَوْ لِيَصْمُتْ. Whoever truly believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Judgment Day, then let them say that which is good. In it there is good. Or at minimum, if they cannot bring themselves or they have nothing good to say, is not to say anything. أَوْ لِيَصْمُتْ. وَالصَّمْتُ نَجَاءُ. You know, being quiet sometimes is a way of attaining salvation. Is a way of attaining salvation. وَمَنْ كَانَ يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ فَلْيُكْرِمْ جَارَهُ. And whoever truly believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on Judgment Day, then let them honor and treat kindly their neighbor. وَمَنْ كَانَ يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ فَلْيُكْرِمْ ضَيْفَهُ. And whoever truly believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Judgment Day, then let them show their generosity and their honor and the proper Muslim etiquettes for their guests. هذا والله تعالى أعلى وأعلم. سبحانك اللهم بحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين. جزاكم الله خيرا. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.